Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 58. So we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Yes, as always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Government License. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today we are absent the bearded Alabama fiend known as Dave Painter. So today we have Lou Feen standing in his place from the Freedom Fiends.
And a bearded Michigan fiend.
Yeah.
much better choice.
So today we have on as a guest Alma Sommer, who is an agorist and unschooling mother, and she's associated with the Jackalope Freedom Festival .com website, as well as undocumentedhuman.com and agoristmarketplace.com. So, and the Facebook page is all in the same names. And we'll just discuss a little bit of that, because the Jackalope Freedom Festival is coming up in August, and some exciting stuff going on. So, Alma, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
No problem.
I have some guests with me as well, so you might get a little background noise.
No problem.
Isn't NyQuil and duct tape part of peaceful parenting?
Possibly.
That's only in the secret handbook, Lou.
I'm not sure if it's aggressive behavior.
It's part of the passive aggressive principle.
Passive aggressive principle, yeah. The non-passive aggressive principle.
So before you get into those things, can you go into a little bit about your agorist and unschooling method, just for people to get a background about you?
Well, my method is we live off-grid, so it's a very unique method, I suppose. It's not really what I say. I don't know how I would term a method, but anyway, we live off-grid, so Neo gets to experience...
Awesome name, by the way.
Thank you. He gets to experience lots of things like his, like, would have, like, I grew up, like, dreaming this is the type of lifestyle I would have had. Like, I wish I just even went camping more often, because my parents, you know, kept me in the valley, in my house, and everything was the same all of the time, you know, sirens, waiting at streetlights, and going to indoctrination camp, and learning about the same thing, and being forced to learn a lot about government, too. So, you know, that's like completely opposite of what his life is, you know, going to be like, which gives him just so much more opportunity, and in my opinion. So that's our method, I guess. So he loves being outside, and so we've spent a lot of time outside, and he's got all kinds of different areas to play in and learn, and he sees other people doing different things, and he gets to learn a lot from them. So
free range kids.
Yep.
Best kind.
How old again?
He's 1.5.
1.5? Okay, so he probably hasn't gotten into all the different size experiments that you can get into being in the outdoors all day long then. Or at least not too many.
He's about the size of a 3-year-old.
Wow.
Oh, really?
He's a big boy. Yeah, but that's great, though. I really wish... I mean, my kids love being outside, but I live in New York, so there's only so much we can do outside, being in the shadow of the city.
Leave.
Yeah, I believe. No, believe me. I'm working on that.
Hey, if you don't like it, move.
That's actually the first time. That's actually the first time Jeremy heard that, right, Jeremy?
Yeah, I believe. I get it all the time.
It is kind of addicting, though. Being around all of those people, I suppose it can be. But I don't know. I liked escaping so much that I learned. I loved it so much. I wanted it to be full time.
Yeah. I have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old, and I'm the father, homeschooling father with them. Monday through Friday, I'm taking them out to different places. So, I think some people who don't like it and complain, I guess, about it, maybe they do so because they weren't able to be raised that way, and so maybe that in some sense makes them annoyed or irritated, which is really weird. It's like, if I suffered, you must suffer. It's like continuing.
Misery loves company.
Right. Continuing the cycle of violence, and then they're surprised that that society is the way it is, and why is there a war? Why are people so hateful and bigoted and intolerant? And
I think it's...
Well, I believe if men had babies, the war wouldn't exist.
Right.
Well, you mean if they gave birth?
There's more to that. Because if you spent 9 months of your life, growing a child inside of you, you wouldn't be so easy to off another human being.
Right.
You as men in general. Any men, maybe a man might feel the same way. Who knows? I have no idea.
I see an awful lot of patriotic women out there that are willing to sacrifice their children to the state because the state is the only modern religion that still demands child sacrifice. And I can't count the number of mothers that have lost children that were posting on Facebook or something else and talking about how their son died protecting his country and how proud they are and everything else. And I understand that it's a defense mechanism because who wants to say, oh, yeah, I handed my kid over to the state and they murdered him. They sent him someplace where he had no business going and now he's dead because of it. Yeah. But that's the reason why they teach kindergarten students to say the Pledge of Allegiance and they don't talk about the wars until later on.
Well, when people lose someone close to them, they make up all sorts of reasons they justify why it happened. So whatever.
Yeah, it's rationalization. It's a defense mechanism.
But sometimes, you could deal with death really bad. So if you actually deal with it, you think they did something good and you're old and that generation isn't going to be around much longer anyway. Oh, I don't know. I call it baby boomerism.
Yeah, or they say that progress happens one funeral at a time, right? Because the people who are stuck in the old ways and don't are rigid and don't want to change, I think that's the beautiful thing about peaceful parenting and unschooling is that we're raising the future, the next generation, the way you want the world to be. That's how you raise your kids, and that's what I say. That's what I'm doing. So tell me a little bit about Jackalope. And why you started that? And it's 2 years old, right? I think
this will be fifth year.
Yeah, the fifth year. Oh my gosh! Yeah, see
2012,
that?
Right? You guys started.
I know where you guys been.
I don't know.
It's expensive to come, to leave the state and go to another state. It's just expensive to travel, no matter what. So I totally get it. I used to travel to New Hampshire. I went there for Porcfest in 2011 and 12. And I came up with the idea for Jackalope in 2011, but it was like Pork West. It was I was doing a Pork West type thing. Mm-hmm. And I got a little bit of grief from some people for that. So then we changed the idea to Scorpiopine with a porcupine with a scorpion tail. And then it ended up turning into Jackalope. So the idea morphed, and it wasn't just me. It was a group of other people who live in Arizona who wanted the same thing. So that's how it started.
When you said you people had a problem with it, I'm guessing people from the FSP were not very happy, or at least supporters of the FSP did not take very kindly to you trying to... that doesn't make any sense to me, because not a lot of people want to travel all the way across the country to New Hampshire. There's a reason a lot of people originally said, hey, you guys are choosing New Hampshire, that's great, but what about everybody on the West Coast who doesn't want to go all the way across the country?
It ends up being $1,000 to fly there and camp and pay. And as the fees started to rise, it just made sense to have something different going on.
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, Lou, and you guys do the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, right? Which is more centralized.
Oh, now I know who to talk to. It's you can't get in touch with anybody. I'm fine. If no one's in charge, I'll just show up. That's cool.
Oh, nobody's in charge there either, I think. But you can always blame Lou. That's what I did.
we do have organizers, and if somebody were to get a hold of me and say, hey, I'm trying to get a hold of organizers, then I can point them in the right direction. I'm sort of an organizer, but I'm not close enough to be a full-blown organizer.
That's what I like. Because then everyone just does their own thing. I don't have to wait around for permission. I don't have to wait around to get in touch with anybody. Seriously.
Yeah, but I do understand where you're coming from with wanting to have something for the people on the West Coast. I'm in northern Michigan, and for me, it's a... little bit over 17-hour drive to Porcfest, going through Kanuckistan if I don't stop for gasoline or anything else. So every rest area stop, every gas station, everything out there adds more time to it. So my base is 17 and a half hours. It's 2 days worth of driving. And if I didn't go through Kanuckistan and go through the border crossings and everything else, my base would be a little over 20 hours. So, yeah, I'm going to Porcfest.
So what if there were 10 stops along your way, to get to Porcfest or something?
Yeah, so this is my last year going, partially because of where I live. But, heck, just to get to Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, it's probably 8, almost 9 hours for me because of where I live in Michigan. I have to go around the Great Lakes, or one of the Great Lakes. So
yeah, but
it's nice to have something to where people don't have to drive 2 days to get to it.
Yeah, we went to Libertopia a couple of years too, so a lot of people come from there.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, it's nice to have. I mean, the idea of Porcfest was great, to try to get as many people together and essentially try to show what a voluntary society on a very small scale can look like. But it's a pain in the ass to travel for a lot of people. I mean, I don't even have to go that far, and I've never been there. This is going to be my first and probably last year, and it's a 6 or 7 hour drive for me. But I think, Lou said, it's great for people on the West Coast. Of course, it makes sense to have something else out there. For people in the Midwest, it makes sense for at least multiple things to be there. And even if they're not these gigantic, festivals and stuff, just starting out and just getting more and more people getting the opportunity to get together. And then if you can manage to travel, then you go visit all the other ones. And that's how the message ends up spreading anyway. So, and you end up, maybe you go to one of these other places and you decide you actually like that area better than the one you're in now. So then you shift there, I don't know. I just think it's silly that people get so... I understand if you're involved in putting them together and, really literally putting your heart and soul into these things, like wanting people to come to yours and actually, have it be more, worth it in that sense. But other than that, I mean, I don't understand why anybody gets upset about people choosing one or going to one and saying, hey, I can't make this one this time around, or I'm going, so what? We want more of these. We don't want to confine it to just one big one that everybody has to go to. That's just ridiculous. I mean, aside from the fact that just creates like a ridiculously weird echo chamber, it's also a great opportunity for all of us to get droned. So, that's just silly.
Jeremy, you're obviously all these freedom festivals need to be regulated with the proper permits and certifications so that they're all so that we have some kind of standard with this freedom festival thing. That's
stop.
Not all the festivals are receiving only half the participants. We need to
just find the closest camping area to you that does not have a state campground in it, and there's like miles and miles and miles of open camping, and start a freaking website and a Facebook page, and then tell all of your friends about it, and then tell them to share it, and then eventually, if you still have a slave job, you can quit it. And there'll be festivals all over the place because all of these people will have left and done that. And we can just go from one to another, like living a completely decentralized life. Since there's like all these strict rules in national forests about how long you can stay and, where you can stay for whatever. And, they drive around and they check out their areas and they have their jurisdiction that they're, whatever, anointed to.
Well, here's something for you. I don't know if you guys have heard about this. Jeremy, you may have heard me talking about it. In Minnesota, like Minneapolis, St. Paul area, they've organized a Agora Fest, and it's pretty small. It was fewer than 100 people last year. I went out there. This year is going to be in Wisconsin at a new location, which is a little bit better for me. It's going to be closer. But you got Agora Fest. I've heard that there's one that's starting up down in Florida. Last year there was a little tiny event, Anarchy on the Allegheny. It was a weekend-long canoe or kayak trip on the Allegheny River, and there was a couple, you know, stop overnight for camping, whatever. And they're doing it again this year. They're hoping that they'll be a lot bigger because I was just a handful of people last year. But it's just these little events.
I have a Facebook page called Freedom Festivals and a group. And if you go and join the group, you can share on a file the festival and the dates. And it's like in a centralized location for festivals and how much the festival costs. And that would be awesome, dude. Like, and send other people there that know about other festivals too, because people want to know where more of them are. I have for years.
Mm-hmm. Now, what's really nice about Agora Fest is when I went out there, there were a couple of people that I had seen on Facebook, but I wasn't Facebook friends with them. So obviously I'd never met any of them before. But well, there's one that is a recent Facebook friend with, because he's a listener to Freedom Fiends. But I didn't know any of these people. I got a chance to make contacts and discuss different things, you know, different anarchist lifestyle type stuff, you know, things that we would discuss, our type of folks would discuss. And I'll be going back, Nick, this coming year, and I think some of them are going to be coming to Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. So
that's awesome. I'm also creating Trail of Anarchy too, so I have that website, and I'm gonna, any of these types of events that cost nothing to camp, vend, or attend, they reach the criteria.
Nice. It's awesome. Like, you know, how, like you said, just anybody, like, you have this idea, you know, I want to start something near me, I'll do it. You know, I'll set it up and I'll make my contacts. And, you know, I love when people take the initiative, you know, like you're like a pioneer, like people, you know, they look at my peaceful anarchism thing and it's like, they're like, this is really cool. You did such a great job for liberty and everything. And I'm like, well, why don't you do it too? All you need is a YouTube channel. It's free. How many Facebook friends do you have? Just talk to people and post it on Facebook and post it on YouTube. I mean, you know, I started just like a few years ago, but it's a lot of fun, you know, and it morphs and develops. And like you say, you started with one name and changed and it changed. And it's just funny how things end up, you know?
Yeah. You invite your friends in, they invite theirs in, and then you have your multi-level marketing scheme. Pretty soon you're a district manager.
Nice. That too.
We'll make like baby yoga workout videos with just the back of Neo's head.
There you go. There's got to be a market for that somewhere. well, see, Lou, it's funny you said that about, I didn't realize that that's what Anarchy on the Allegheny was. I remember seeing the announcements for it last year, and I just saw one for it today for this year's one. But that's actually a really great idea, because I would love to... I know I'm not going to be able to make that one, but I would love to schedule something like that, maybe at least in upstate New York, where I wouldn't have to deal with the BS down here. Because that's something I used to do every year up in Maine without anarchists. It'd be so much more fun with anarchists. Oh, my God.
Everything is more fun with anarchists, Jeremy. Come on.
Well, something else, like, I live in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. I'm out in BFE, Bear Saskatchewan. And most of my friends are down in the southeastern part of Michigan, down the Mitten area, Detroit area. So I invite people to come up here. It's pretty much a standing invitation to all those friends down there to come up here. But like on long holiday weekends or something like that, I'll put together an event. And a lot of people have been able to get up here, and they don't like traveling on holiday weekends. But putting stuff like that together, and I've been able to meet a couple of the other anarchists that live up here. And make these connections. So
I have an idea, and if you guys are interested, maybe we should talk about it offline. But yes, it has to do with connecting these dots.
Sure.
Well, okay. Yeah. One other thing about camping, though, if you look at when you go into a campground, the people might be status there, but they do live an anarchist lifestyle. And aside from the guy that as soon as he puts his camper in, before he levels it out, he has to put his flag, his American flag out on the thing. If you look at the way people live their lives in the campgrounds, the respect that they have for each other and property rights, like for the most part, it'll be very rare for somebody to just walk right into your campsite, walk up to you at your campfire and start blabbering at you. And they will stop at the edge of the campsite and wait to be invited over.
Mm-hmm.
So you really have these people that are already living this type of lifestyle or mentality, and who knows, maybe some of them are fertile minds to reach out to and plant some seeds of liberty in them.
Yeah. Yeah, I just handed out a couple Spanish Bitcoin pamphlets to this woman who let me use the restroom in a gas station, and she was speaking Spanish, and I don't have any English ones left, so I gave her two of them.
Nice.
Yeah, there you go. It's a great way to spread information. Oh, thank you for using your bathroom. Here, read this.
I showed her which part was important to read.
No, that's nice. Good though. That's, you know, if you
I have. Mean, they probably send money to Mexico if they're here. So if they know they can do it without being charged a transaction fee, why wouldn't they do it in Bitcoin?
Exactly.
When is the festival in Florida?
I don't know. I don't think it's going to happen for a year or two. Something like that. I remember seeing something briefly about it, and I'm like, Florida? Wait, in the summertime? Are you serious? Because it was rather early in the year. I don't do well with heat. That's why I live as far north as I do.
Yeah, well, if you come to Jackalope, it's like super cool because it's in the pines, and you might, if you fly into Phoenix, it'll be hot, but if you drive, once you drive up north, it's not hot anymore, and it does rain, so bring something to keep the rain out and off.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard that northern Arizona has like normal climate. It might be some desert in there, but it actually gets snow and rain, and it's not always a blazing 90 plus degrees year round.
Yeah, it was still just like below freezing where we are a couple weeks ago.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah, same here. This past weekend I went camping, and the campsite that I usually go to still had snow on it, so I couldn't throw my tent there. And mind you, I was driving around with the air conditioner on Sunday, and I got sunburn on my arms while I was fishing. But there's still snow all over the place.
Yep, that happens.
Something about Jackalope that I had heard, and I don't know if this is true, and so you correct me on this. It's not really, my understanding is you don't buy tickets in advance, you get information and you show up. Is that how it's set up?
Yeah, I mean, I run the website and the Facebook page and the group. I mean, I'm the admins of them, but it's national forest, so it's free to camp and free to vend, free to attend. There is no registration fees or sign-up sheets or anyone telling you where to go. It's, I mean, there's a map and it says where the location is, and there's directions on how to get to where people are camping. So, yeah, you get there and then you do your thing.
Okay. What sort of events do you have going on there, other than like the vending and walking around, things like that?
Well, there's many different individuals that come and set up.
Okay, so do they have like speaking events, kind of like at Porcfest or maybe some of the other festivals, or discussion?
Yeah,
groups?
There's no big giant like building area or anything like that, because it's all set up by individuals. But every year since the first year, I've created somewhat of a stage. So the last few years we've had a trailer and I get PA system from Ernest Hancock. He lets me borrow it, and people speak and play music and do whatever they want.
Okay, so just kind of a spontaneous order, everything pops up and the schedule gets filled and people are doing their presentations or leading discussions?
Yeah, in the one year I actually even tried to sort of organize it a little bit ahead of time. Like I just had a Google Doc I created that was blank and I had sent it to some people. It was like a nightmare. Some issues came up and I was like, I'm never doing this again. Who would want this?
Oh, really? Trust me, I know. We've dealt with that with the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. The first year, it was just straight up spontaneous order. And there weren't a whole lot of presentations. And most of the discussions were happening at picnic tables and campfires. And most of the people were just taking off and going, doing the outdoors camping activities, things like that, fishing with their kids and singing songs, barbecuing, walking around and chit-chatting with other people. And I thought that was really good. When I go to Porcfest, I catch very few of the presentations. I think when I went to Porcfest in 2013, the only presentations that I went were done by Michael Dean, Bill Buport or Ben Stone. And I caught a little bit of the other ones, but I had friends that were there. They had their schedule set up on their smartphone, and they were figuring out where they're going to go and which tent they had to be in at all these times. It's like, my God, it's like having a job trying to figure out all the stuff to do.
Right.
And all expo has like 100 other different topics going on at the same time as everything else, which is awesome.
Yeah, when I was there, Old Expo got moved inside, so their tent was in by the other tents. You didn't have to go over to the other side of Rogers Campground or outside.
Yeah, I can understand what not having gone to actually any of these yet, it makes a lot of sense, though, that I guess it would be nice to have those things there if you're not the one setting them up. But like you said, Lou, anybody who's going to actually try to catch these things and have to like abide by a schedule, like that just seems like it seems like the antithesis of actually going to one of these things and relaxing and having fun and getting to just experience, you know, different people and different ideas and different, you know, and sort of a different type of lifestyle, especially for one of the week-long ones. That just seems like way too much. I don't know.
Go ahead. You have to go back to your day job to get the rest of relaxation that you need after your vacation.
No, Porcfest is pretty relaxing. I mean, honestly, even if you filled your phone with everything in the schedule, you could just be standing around and look at your phone going, okay, what's going on right now? There's 5 things going on. I don't feel like doing any of them.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. To have it there, to be able to say, sure, yeah, if I want to go to something, great. Yeah, that's probably awesome. But anybody that's actually trying to make these things on the schedule, that just seems, you know, ridiculous.
That's what a mesh network is for.
Yeah. I didn't have to look at my phone to know that I didn't want to go to all those things.
Yeah. Well, like, we're going to have it. There's a group called JackNet, and there's some people in there discussing how to create different types of jacknets, so mesh networks for Jackalope, and people will be able to log into them and quite possibly build their own website and make announcements and advertisements and tell people where they are and what their specials are and what they're doing or what they're speaking about. So that'll take care of that type of organization.
Nice. Hey, what do you have for music there at the festival?
Not enough, please. If you are in that network, I got out of that music network years ago. So, and I'm a mom. I'm not in the Valley anymore. I'm trying to tap into it, but I need the help. I need help.
Okay. Do you have musicians show up, like actual musicians that play in bands and perform live and stuff like that? Or is it maybe the hippies that show up and they strum the banjo around their campfire?
All of the above.
Okay.
Nice. Any rappers come and perform there?
Yes, Fetty Profound. Fetty Profound has come to perform. And he's been a long time Liberty friend, so check him out. He's awesome.
Cool, never heard of him. Cool. The first festival I went to was with Jeremy, Liberty Fest, and I was very happy he asked me to go because I don't think I would have went otherwise. But
NYC?
It was awesome. In Brooklyn. In Brooklyn, yeah. And oh man, I mean, I think the best part about going to a festival like that is the casual conversation. Not the speeches really, but the stuff that you learn, the connections you make, the networks you make. You know, you can't put a price on that. And you can't schedule those things either. That's the most important thing. That's the best. That's what I look forward to, those kinds of things.
Yeah, there's no lack of campfire conversation at Jackalope.
Oh, go ahead, Lou.
I prefer those smaller, more intimate, quieter events. And Diana had a really good explanation for comparison between like the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest and Pork Fest. And she said that ultimately the smaller festivals are more intimate. You don't have as many people there. You also don't have all the celebritarians running around like, oh, look at me. Do you want my autograph? Or, you know, just all the stuff.
Oh, Adam will be there this year. So, you know, one will show up. Usually one shows up.
Adam showed up to Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest last year. He happened to be in Michigan on his freedom tour, and somebody had sent him an email. He's like, okay, yeah, sure, I'll come out there. And so he and his girlfriend, dog, and the camper showed up, and did the little speech on
yeah,
Sunday.
Yeah, he loves camping. He lives in a trailer.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, it was kind of neat to meet him. Cool. Had a nice little interview with him. But and I also thought he was pretty down to earth, too. But
yes.
At these smaller events, you have a lot more opportunity to go over to somebody's easy up and sit around there and just shoot the bull.
Yeah. Well, that's why, you know, Danilo
brought up. Especially if they're cooking.
Well, that's why I want to hang with Lou at Porcfest. That's
the assault kitchen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's why when the plans got all screwed up, I was like, oh, I'm not going to be actually at the assault kitchen when I wake up in the morning. That's so sad. It almost made me not want to go.
you're staying with Joe and Nicole's site.
I'm not staying. Right? Oh, I'm not. Yes, I'm not staying with you though. I was going to wake up to the assault kitchen. Now I have to actually walk somewhere. Man, come on.
Or not. Just pass out on the grass.
Hey, numbnuts! You're in the next site. Oh. You're in the adjoining site.
I thought you didn't
behind.
Get. I thought you didn't get that one.
No, I'm checking up with the Freedom Fiends webmaster.
Oh, I gotcha. Okay.
The Slopies.
Gotcha. Well,
Derek.
Yeah.
Yes.
I know Derek.
Derek and Donna. Yeah.
And Derek's getting around. Every time I hear something, I hear his name. He's like taking care of everyone. Lots of people. He's doing business good.
Yes.
Good. That's awesome.
Yeah, well, I mean, you guys are talking about these, you know, the more intimate events, which I actually would enjoy more, I'm sure. Because anytime I did camping trips, if they got to be too many people, it just was too much for me. But, you know, Danilo brought up Liberty Fest. Like, that's what we have here in New York. A one day.
Yeah, yeah.
One day, maybe if you're lucky. Maybe two
days. It's 2 days. Yeah, it's two days.
Yeah. Well, no, it used to only be one. Now they started extending it to two. Nice. But it's just 2 days, and you know, it's in the city where you go and hang out for the day, and then you have to leave. I mean, granted, the last one I went to, I ended up speaking of Adam. I actually had it because a friend of mine was there who knew Adam. We actually ended up going out for drinks with him and a couple other people. But it's in the city. It's loud. It's obnoxious. I try to avoid the city like the plague as it is. So these, you know, events like this, being able to go out and camp and just get away from everything else and get to be with people and get to mingle and talk, you know, like you said, just sit down anywhere and say, hey, how you doing? strike up a conversation and, you know, make some new friends I don't know. Like I said earlier, I really wish more people would get involved in this and just, you know, like you said, just even just small, like start with five people. Who cares?
It doesn't matter. Seriously, there was maybe 70 our first year. Maybe.
Yeah.
I didn't take any kind of census report. Never.
All right, everybody in a single file.
Register your shells. Show us your papers.
We have a deregistration table.
Deregistration table. That's great.
People did fill out the forms. This is very funny because some of the questions are kind of invasive. We do have a form, but it's just a joke.
The first Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, there was a registration for it, and because we had it in a state campground, when this thing was put together, I wasn't even part of the group yet, but they said, hey, let's do it here. It's a big area and, you know, lakes and everything else, and now it's. Now it's a private location, but they had to have reservations made, and they had to have a deposit on the location. So that's why they had the pre-registration and paying in advance and everything. So with Jackalope, since it's no pay camping, just show up and do your thing, I can see where that'd be a whole lot easier for you guys. But like our current location, we have to put down a $300 deposit each year. Something like that.
Hmm. Yeah, well, it's got to be more.
Get donations for that, then, and then make it free.
Yeah, well, the place that they were at this year, well, for the past 2 years and this year, they charge by the people. So it'd be kind of hard to do the donations. And
why we keep being counted as livestock?
As private property. That's how they want to run it.
Yeah, that's why we get porta potties, and when they need to be emptied, we take care of it. Like, everyone takes care of it.
Tip them over?
No. The porta potty company comes and empties them and makes them fresh.
I did it last time. Who's next?
but who would empty the porta potties without a central planning committee for the event?
That's so ridiculous. We're going to take sponsors this year just in case, you know, it helps get it covered quicker and it advertises for somebody. So $75 a porta potty if you want to sponsor a porta potty at Jackalope this year.
And sponsor it goes
all of it goes towards the paying for porta potties.
Now, if you could get a porta potty with side by side commodes in there, then maybe the Freedom Fiends would step up and do some support.
Are you saying you want to pee at the same time as somebody else?
Not
you
exactly.
Haven't seen the pictures?
I think I missed something.
Oh gosh.
there's now a series, I think, actually. There's definitely more than two at least, isn't there?
You want like dual urinals? Is that what you're saying?
No, not urinals.
Not urinals.
Toilets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Without a divider.
There's something.
I'll see what I can do. It might be like temporarily built for the weekend or week or something, but you know, there's lots of rocks and tree branches out there, so it's possible you could have a dual sitting toilet if that's what you're into.
I'm looking for the picture.
Just start building it the minute you get there, and by the end of your excursion, it will have been built. And maybe it'll be there next year. Maybe. If you hide it good. If we hide a bunch of them, then maybe they'll be there every year. Who knows? But, like, that land up there, like, you could bring your whole Liberty crew and camp in a completely different area than Baca Meadows and advertise that you're there somehow. I'll advertise it on the website at the very least and have someone taxiing people back and forth to different, you know, hangout areas, camp areas, whatever, music areas, whatever you got going on.
Yeah, well, that's the difference then with the, because it's the, well, it's quote unquote federal land, right? That's what you're dealing with out there. So the national park, right? Right.
My personal research of the specific land that we're on the county website, the parcel information, it's like an old family property, the Baca family. There's even a sign that talks about it. And when you check the county website, there's no parcel information. So it doesn't actually say anyone owns it because there's no information. But all of the surrounding parcels have APN numbers with square footage that are like copied and duplicated and like above each other and next to each other. So it's like proves it's completely fraudulent, you know?
Okay.
Okay. Well. Alma, if you check the comments here in the Skype chat.
Yeah, I just saw it.
Oh, you might not be able to see it until afterwards because you're on a mobile device. At the Porcfest a couple years ago, Michael Dean and I got pictures sitting on toilets that did not have the divider up. They were remodeling some of the bathrooms there, so they didn't have the dividers up, and you can see the drywall has the marks on from when they were covering up screws and bolts and whatever, and I guess they've done the remodeling on the drywall, but they still don't have dividers up. By the way, I was drunk, and somebody asked us if we would take pictures holding hands sitting on the bloody toilets, and we went in there, we dropped our pants and took a couple pictures, and then by about 20 to 30 minutes later, uncountable numbers of people had walked in with their cell phones, cameras, and taken pictures, and then the pictures were memed and thrown up all over the internets, and I'm sure somebody had a heart attack over it. And here we are a couple years later.
Well, I like making memes, so maybe you'll get another one.
Nice.
And then it was repeated last year. Was it last year they repeated?
Yeah, last year.
Derek
last year
J. and
Diana.
Diana.
Yeah, but Diana put a paper bag over her head. I guess she wanted to be the unknown comic or the unknown squatter.
Don't we all?
Yeah.
Well, not you, not you and Michael. You guys were champs.
Yeah, and Derek J's junk was covered by a BIPCOT no government license. Literally.
Oh, that's too funny. I don't remember if I actually saw that picture. I remember hearing about it.
Well, I think it's the sexiest picture of two men sitting next to each other on a toilet ever.
There you go.
I'm hoping there's not a whole lot of those out there. But if there were...
Oh, I've seen the sexiest one I've seen.
Okay. So for the listeners out there, I can't see this. This meme that I posted is, it has some microphones photoshopped in there and some audio equipment. And it says, the Morning Zoo Crew radio show. It's the Freedom Fiends' new gig, doing the Morning Zoo Crew. KLIK Beast Lick, Wyoming. All right, let's get back to the festivals, because I think we derailed the conversation with all the toilet talk.
enough potty humor for now. So why don't we, before we get too far away from it, so again, you're just a recap, you're the Jackalope Festival is what, the first week of August this year, right?
First through the eighth.
And just grab your stuff and show up. So
yeah, because 3 days wasn't long enough. You know how it goes.
Yeah. See, and you mentioned earlier about the travel expenses and stuff. Unfortunately, like Lou talks about driving all the way to Porcfest for him, I would probably try to find some way to drive to it. For me, it's unfortunately the timing. Any of the events in August are just like completely off limits to me because of my business. And
what's your business?
I have a pet sitting company, and
you can bring them with you.
I can't bring other people's animals with
charge extra because they're going on an excursion.
If I can,
you got a permit to carry those dogs across state lines.
Exactly, that would be my problem.
Those are roaming dogs.
Yeah, unfortunately, because I interchange dogs so often, and I also have to go to other people's houses. It just doesn't work. August is just because same reason I missed I have to keep missing the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. I wish I could. It's just a horrible time for me.
It sounds like you're just gonna have to like kick ass and then save up a bunch and then take off a whole month, or have two different jobs and you do that one for a month.
Well, eventually I'm gonna find my way out of this business. Hopefully, I need to find something else to do because I do want to get out of New York, and my business is tying me. Well, my business and my kids are currently tying me to New York. But once I figure out something else to do and can get away from here, I would be more than happy to do it. And then I won't have to worry about August being a busy month for me, hopefully.
Yeah, well, if you can plan a trip of markets on your way there, then you could make money at all of the markets you stop at along the way.
Yeah, that's the one. Unfortunately, my business is not built for that.
You know, actually, I'll just throw this out there. There's a lot of dogs that come camping, so like mm-hmm. you could actually like maybe contain them and play with them for a little while, and owners might like.
There you go. Daycare for Bitcoin,
Jeremy. Right.
We have a jackalope hunt for the kids. Why not like some kind of hunt for the dogs?
You know,
as a matter of fact, you'll see people chalk the roads going through the campgrounds at Rogers for Porcfest, and it will advertise dog sitting, babysitting, just all these different things. Go to a campsite such and such, or Texas number, and the child labor there is just off the charts. those kids are running around making mad coin.
Take Dash.
Yeah, they whip out their little cell phone and say, "Here, hit me up." pay me. I'll take care of your dog. Here, scan my QR code.
Give him a Dash QR code.
That's awesome, though. If my kids were a little older, they'd be doing that, too.
Heck yeah. I'm going to put it on Neo's T-shirt or something. Donate to Neo.
Now, speaking of kids, what are the kids' activities that are lined up and what usually winds up happening there as far as kid activities?
Well, they're very good at occupying themselves. They play that like murder game or whatever, and we have a jackalope hunt, and I've split up the ages now so that it's harder for the older ones. There's three different groups, and each winner gets a real rabbit from the Magpok homestead, so that's kind of cool. You can either eat it or keep it as a pet. I'm probably going to get a bunch of angry comments for that. Like, the vegans are in full force, let me tell you, man. They are like, you're violating the nap, you meat eater. And I'm like,
the murderer.
How dare you? Yes, I know, dude. You are. If you eat commercially grown food, you pretty much are, yeah. They're bringing it to everyone's attention. I don't know why I am.
Hey, listen, if the child wants to eat his rabbit, the child should be able to eat his rabbit. Let him do it in peace. I don't even want to get into it about the vegans. They
especially if he's starving, because like it was cold and his carrots froze or some shit. I don't know if I'm supposed to, if I can cuss or not on your show.
Oh my god, the FCC is going to shut us down. Thanks a lot, Alma.
I know Ernie is syndicated a couple of places, so he tries not to say bad words.
Yeah, no, we're not syndicated, so we don't have to worry about that. And Dave's not here, so the cursing is actually at a very minimum anyway. So we're more than fine.
Probably shouldn't be coming from the mother.
I come on shows like this so that I can curse, because I'm syndicated. I think we're on 30 some stations across the country. Well, actually, around the world.
Yes.
So I have to be careful what I say there, and I'm in such a habit of not cursing that when I have an opportunity to drop the F-bomb on shows like this, I often forget to do it.
But damn it. I was just going to say that, talking about, children, starting their own businesses and earning money when they're young, I think that's so awesome. And, especially with homeschoolers and unschoolers, I noticed that happens a lot. Like, and I've talked to quite a few unschoolers. I've interviewed quite a few, and that's a very common thing where they say, yeah, my child has a business, started at, 10 years old, 11 years old, and that's awesome. It's like, isn't that a success in your eyes, that they can be learn how to be self-sufficient eventually, very much quicker?
Yeah.
Until the kid lobbies the city council to crush the younger competition.
Right. Well, if they're going to choose to stay in the United States, they're probably going to have to use Federal Reserve notes for a little bit longer. So until they don't exist anymore, and or until enough people in his or her local network is using cryptocurrencies or some other kind of trade network, if it's large enough, then they can completely survive off of that. And there are people that have figured it out. It's not like a new idea. So it's really whatever we can create for them and leave them with.
Now, going back to the kids' activities at Jackalope, do you have like some hippies that'll do some arts and crafts and things like that?
Sure. The kids are—you could call them hippies. They do arts and crafts. There are some hippie parents, I guess, and they bring craft supplies for their kids. So there's some different things like that for sure. Yeah.
Okay, because my hippies, Jason and Mary, they're always creating artwork out of all sorts of stuff. They repurpose the roads. Like they'll find the yellowish orange paint or tape or whatever that's on the road, and they'll make wallets out of it. And all sorts of crazy stuff. You'd have to see it to believe it. I love them. Those hippies are so damn cool. But
well, Jackalope could definitely use original everything. So
They're kind of nocturnal. They're kind of like cats. They sleep a lot during the day, but then they go around in the middle of the night at Porcfest, and they'll decorate your campsite while you're asleep. So, kind of like you have no idea what your cats are doing while you're asleep at home. That's how my hippies are.
Your hippies.
Yeah. So, and you feed them, you water them, and keep them happy. Plenty of bacon keeps their coats nice and shiny.
There's a very large meadow. I mean, it's called Baca Meadow, so there's like a very large meadow that they go, do like a nature.
Your hippies can graze in?
Local herb. I'm sorry, what?
I said the big meadow where your hippies can graze, apparently.
Yes, there's a big meadow.
Let them graze a little bit.
Nice.
Yes, there's a grazing hippie area.
Stretch their legs, get a little run in,
That's funny.
Take them out on the hippie run. So, do you have like a river or lake nearby for fishing or swimming or anything like that?
There's a really, really small lake called Black Canyon Lake, and it's not really any good. So unfortunately, there's not really great water. And but if you stay for like even longer, then you can travel and do all sorts of different things. And there are other areas in Arizona that have awesome places to fish.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because one of the nice things about the different Liberty Facet at both the locations that we've been to is there have been lakes there. So in the dog days of summer, you could put on your swim trunks or not and go on over and cool down.
You could probably do that there if you want. And if it's rained enough, it might look kind of fresh.
Might look kind of fresh.
Yeah. Well, usually on Monday morning, because the Midwest Peace of Liberty Fest breaks up on Monday morning, I'll cook breakfast for everybody that's still there. And last year's like, I don't know, probably about 20-some, 30 people. And after everything's broken down and we've policed up the area, made sure there's no junk left behind, we would all go down to the beach and go swimming one last time, bathe, and, you know, so you got a bunch of hippies there rubbing each other down with their loofahs and everything. And
nice.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy looking. It would probably freak some people out, but, you know, good.
There's hot springs in Arizona. You can go to the Verde Hot Springs, and there's Fossil Springs, and there's all kinds of different places in up here.
Nice.
Yeah, I would suggest sticking around for a couple of weeks if you work for yourself and you can afford to do it. And also, if you do want to raise like a funding campaign to come here, I'll promote you on the website and whatever currency you're trying to use.
Nice.
Pay my way to Jackalope.
Now that's something I'd like to do, is get out there.
Yeah. Well, if you tell your network, they might get excited. I already have 3 Patreons on our Patreon, which is surprising to me. Like, are you kidding? I didn't even think we would have 1, and we have 3. So, you know, nice. There's that. If you need a referral link, use a friend who's already signed up. Referral link if you're going to sign up on Patreon. They compensate.
Oh, nice. Yeah, my goal is to be self-employed, doing some media production in the next few years, and be able to basically travel to all these different places. Just, yeah, you know, hook the camper up to the pickup truck and take off.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah.
So when are you going to be hiring, Lou?
I don't know. It's going to depend upon if I have enough dogs to justify the expense.
No, I'm talking about switching careers. Come on now.
Is your family ready to go full-time in a tiny house or an RV?
My family, not currently. Yeah, there's a lot to be worked out there. If things were different, I probably would have been, because I wanted to go the tiny house route already, which is actually kind of a joke with me, because I already live in a 920 square foot house.
So it won't be change for you.
Yeah, for me it won't be a huge thing. My kids,
my family,
you'll own it and you can take it anywhere you want.
This is true. That's what I would like to do it. But again, I unfortunately, it's my own fault. I was lazy for a very long time, and I didn't figure out any backup plans, and kind of just stumbled into the business that I'm in now. And I've been at it for 11 years, and I've been very successful with having to put minimal work into it, just time. And, you know, I've done really well, but I didn't come up with a backup plan when I was like, yeah, all right, now I'm getting to an age where I don't know if I want to do this anymore, but what do I do now?
You're working right now.
No, exactly.
You're doing your liberty working.
Yeah.
You're working for Liberty.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Unfortunately, Liberty tends not to pay. I've learned, because I do this show. I do the Freedom Fiends with Lou. I don't get paid for any of this stuff.
What's happening?
I just do it because I like to talk and people are willing to listen to me. So I said, sure, why not? But yeah,
okay, so you can get a little button that has your QR code on it. And so while you're right here talking and people are watching, when they watch this, they can just scan it while they watch it every time they like something you say. Like, I'm just waiting for a Bitcoin Periscope.
Yeah, look. There's an idea.
Every time I tap it, and I'm not going to take this one on, so this one's free. Every time I tap it, it sends them Bitcoin instead of like a heart or a Bitcoin heart, whatever.
That's pretty
really?
Cool. Well, no, that's cool.
Any cryptocurrency. It could be multiple ones. It could be a way to exchange. Oh, gosh. Go. Take it. It's free.
somebody, please do this. Yes. Yeah, I don't have tech skills, but I'm sure somebody out there will get on it. Come on.
Now, for me, I don't have a family. It's just me and my girlfriend, and she's here probably about every few weeks. She comes out for a couple weeks. But what I would like to do is to have a camper or something like that, and Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, does this. he lives in a mobile home.
Yep.
He and his wife do, and they have their little car that they pull behind it, you know, their little two door, and that they use for driving around town and things like that. But they live out of that mobile home, and they'll go spend a couple weeks at some mobile home campsite, and they have all the comforts of home in there. You know, the refrigerator, you know, good sized refrigerator, bathroom, and when they're hooked up to the water and stuff like that at the campground, or even the satellite TV, cable, internet, whatever, they have all that stuff available to them, and they're able to live out of that. And if they get tired of living there, they can move. You know, I mean, yeah. Literally, they can go from one spot to another. But I mean, they've been down in the south in the Gulf Coast area for a couple of years now. They haven't been back to Ohio since, as far as I know.
But, we should start a website at the house status is this campground.
And aside from the people putting out the flags, which I think is more habitual, you don't see a whole lot of love for the government in there.
A lot of those are like, they love old America, and they're like going to love it till they die.
Yeah, it's a lot of old veterans that are like, well, yeah, I know deep down that I fought for a corrupt government, but hell, I can't admit it now because then, you know, then I'm really going to feel like a chump. So I'll just keep living the lie.
They lived the lie so long that I don't think they could. Well, I mean, look at the veterans that commit suicide. They can't handle the lie.
Yeah. Well, when somebody thanks me for my service, I literally cringe more often than not. I get this involuntary look on my face, this involuntary reaction of, seriously? What are you thanking me for? Do you have any idea of the things I've done? Mm. No. What did I do that you appreciate so much? And then they'll come back with some other canned answer like, oh, well, your sacrifice. Well, when I was in Germany, the only thing that really got sacrificed was my liver.
that type of stuff, people saying that to you, is actually habitual.
It's reflexive, right? That's a good word.
It's like
maybe somebody say, if we didn't serve our masters, they would have beat us.
Right. Yeah. I was at a park recently with my kids, and the kids were playing on this. There was like a monument, but I didn't know it was a monument. And then it was like fenced in. There was like rocks and flowers, and I was with a bunch of other homeschooler kids, and they were playing in that area with the flowers and the rocks and the monument. And then this older gentleman comes over and he says, "Are those your kids? Do you know that that's a war memorial?" And he just walked away. And then and then I looked over and I made sure to read, and it's like, in defense, or in memory of those that sacrificed their lives in defense of our great nation, something like that. And I made sure to tell the homeschooling mothers there, like, you see, focus on this word, defense of our great nation, in defense, going over an ocean in defense, right? Focus on that phrase, please, okay?
Oh, you're focused on that part. I was thinking more along the lines of, I would have told them, well, they're celebrating life.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, yeah. That's the other thing. Like, if this was
they're real, alive like, because of this. Like, come on.
Well, the other thing is, I would have said is, wouldn't you want the kids to be happy? Like, isn't that what flowers and rocks are for? Like, for kids to be happy.
They'd be crying and lighting holes.
Right.
Is there any greater vision of freedom than children playing and laughing? Right. Didn't those people fight for
life?
Freedom? Fight for freedom? Didn't they fight for children to be able to play and laugh? Way back when the Germans stole American freedom and they had it hidden in bunkers all across Germany, American soldiers went over there and they recovered it.
Yes.
Back when the North Vietnamese took the right to vote and they were hiding it in the little tunnels in the jungle, American tunnel rats went in there and they grabbed that right to vote, they put it in their backpack, and they brought it back to America. So quit being such an ungrateful fucking cur.
Amen.
See, I knew I could go the whole show without saying fuck.
There you go. Oh, you guys, You guys are right, though. Obviously, it's funny because yes, that is what they supposedly fought for, but and they want them to do that, just not on the special, just not in the special places.
We fought for your freedom.
The special,
not the special places.
Now quit using it.
Just quit using the special places.
The stolen money paid places.
Well, yeah, but that's all monuments and all quote unquote government property. It's supposedly paid for by you, but you're only allowed to be on it at certain times or not on it at all, or you get frowned upon for looking at it funny. Like
even it's like that even on your own land.
Well,
of course. It's insane. We live in insane. I don't know what people are doing. They're just sitting at their jobs going, it's my job. Well, quit your job. There's like food banks all over the place. You're not going to starve.
Look, right. Freedom is like fine china. You don't actually use it every day. You put it on the in the cabinet and you save it for special occasions.
If you're living your life because you're in debt, like don't kill yourself. Just quit using FRNs and save yourself.
Right, but most people feel like that's the only option, those FRNs, you know, when they don't know Bitcoin, or all they know of Bitcoin is, you know, then the lamestream media when they, you know, talk about all the Mount Gox and all the you know, people getting robbed of their Bitcoins, and like, you see, it's corrupt. It has to do with drugs and with, you know,
illicit. Yeah, because FRNs have never been stolen or used for drug purposes.
Exactly. Exactly. Right.
Well, it's just getting the knowledge. I mean, it's still, unfortunately, there's still so many people that have never even heard of Bitcoin. I come across them all the time. I mean, we were talking about before, you know, taking a business and trying to do it outside of FRNs. I've been trying to do it for the last, now, 16 months, I guess, with my business. I officially announced it last January that I was making a shift and I was going to try to go in this direction. And it wasn't until a month ago that I finally got my first Bitcoin transaction. And while it was a very momentous occasion, I was sad because it took so long. And I was also sad because it ended up having to be a friend of mine who came in from out of town and was willing to pay me in Bitcoin. So none of my it was still good, but none of my existing clients, like, I've gotten them to shift away from other things, and I do get to educate them, but they're still so, you know, at least they know now. But out of all, you know, I have like 300 total human clients on my roster, so there's, you know, like 100 or so I see regularly. Out of those 100, I think maybe 5 of them had actually heard of it beyond just hearing the name.
Well, yeah, the news isn't telling people about it.
Yeah.
Hey, guys, another currency that's not printed out of thin air.
But even the bad stories, like they didn't even know the Mount Gox, or they didn't know about the Silk Road and what the travesty of what happened to Ross and everything. Like they didn't even know that. They had just, those people had just maybe heard the name somewhere, somebody said it. But like 5 out of 100, if I was lucky, actually were like, oh, yeah, I know a little bit about it. All of them still too leery to actually. I tried to convince them. I tried to say, hey, I'll help you set up a wallet, and, you know, I'll even throw like, you know, a tiny little bit in there to just show you how it works and all this stuff. And they were still, and they're my clients. They're how I make my money currently. So I didn't want to push them. I just said, okay, just remember this option's always open. So,
but Jeremy, you don't understand. Bitcoin's not backed by anything, right? FRNs, they're backed by the full faith of the federal government.
Yeah, right.
I get that all the time.
If you run a red light and you don't pay that fine, the government will issue a judgment against your bank account, and your bank will let them steal your money. So you're not free. And they just want to keep stealing more of your money so they can buy land and not let you go on it.
Yes, this is true.
The full faith and credit of an organization that has $19 trillion in debt.
Exactly.
Yeah, but see, that would require connecting the dots in order for them to make that realization.
Yeah, one of the problems is we're dealing with people that are indoctrinated in the government indoctrination gulags. I guess I should say educated. I know that most of the listeners here are going to understand what I mean by when I say indoctrinated. And there's a meme that I've seen. You can't expect a government to teach you to be free or something like that, or to teach you about freedom. I think Malcolm X had a quote, never entrust your enemy to educate your children.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, that's a good. Yep.
I call it government school. I mean, I was calling it indoctrination camp for a while, but sometimes that does go over people's heads. So government school is like exactly what it is. And when you say that to people, it like makes them think about it. Really, it does.
Yeah. It does. It does. Yeah, people do realize when I say that. They're like, you're right, actually, it is. I guess. Yep.
Now, when I'm talking to Republicans, you know, the bootlicking cop roaches or cop suckers, I make sure to refer to the cops as the government.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, like, especially when you're talking to them, be like, you went to government school like I did, right?
Exactly.
Make connections.
The government enforcers. The government. That's enforcers. Our police. Oh, really? Our police. How many tickets have they given you, and how many politicians have they arrested? Well, but, you know.
It's not the government. It's just Joe. He lives a couple of houses down from me. He's got three kids. You know, I barbecue.
Okay. This is his business or something like that? He owns this business, and he just goes out and raises tickets to people? No, he's a government enforcer.
Yeah.
Well, so one of my first websites I started when I became an activist was agorismarketplace.com, and it's free for anyone who accepts an alternative currency to get connected on there, and it's always been set up that way. So I haven't been like very active since I had a child, but I just went on there and did some moderation, and I'm going to be adding a forum too, just because I realized that these people probably actually really rather communicate with each other and not have to wait for me to like do something. So
nice.
What sort of things happen on the agorismarketplace.com? What can we find on there? What can we find if we go look at it right now?
Well, it's basically a connection page of agorist. So you can search different categories and find something you're looking for, and you can message them and see if they'll take whatever currency you want to pay.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. Cool.
It's not like in the thousands or anything. I think I'm like literally just into the hundreds or something. But yeah, I mean, it's a lot of people I've connected with over the years. So.
All right, cool. Well, before your phone dies, we should probably wrap this up. Thanks a lot, Alma, for coming on the show. I really appreciate it talking to you. Never really heard about a lot of this stuff that, you know, your website, so I'm really, I love it when I see all these different freedom festivals, even if yours is 5 years old. I just heard about it, so it's new to me. but yeah, really
I'm the
awesome.
Best marketing person, you know, whatever. I myself and like my friends.
I like on your Facebook page, you're like, I am not the owner of Jackalope. I am not. I do not run the Facebook page. I do not. I like that. But yeah, I really appreciate you coming on the show. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to meet you, Alma.
Nice to meet you too.
Before, if you just want to plug everything really quick before you run out.
The only other thing was, if you're choosing to have a child in the United States, I guess, and you want them to have an opportunity to be free, and you're going to have them in a hospital, there are no laws saying that you have to give them any kind of government documentation. So you are free until you are enslaved by your parents. Just leave you with that. And if anyone else has any stories about being undocumented or emancipated or stateless or anything like that, I will post them on undocumentedhuman.com.
Oh, cool. Yeah, well, I could talk about that for hours. I have my own story about that. maybe we'll have you back another time. We could discuss that issue. But I really appreciate you coming on, and I hope people who are available at the beginning of August can make their way out to the Jackalope Festival out in Arizona. And also, before we run, Lou, you want to plug your stuff before, you know, and thank you for filling in for Dave. It's always a pleasure to have somebody else other than Dave, especially you.
Kidding, a little Dave, more clean shaven, little less beard.
Yeah. Less beard, more brains. You can find me on the freedomfiends.com. I am one of the co-hosts there. I'm on every Wednesday night, or nearly every Wednesday night, and then I pop on occasionally to help out or to yak about something important, or if I can't sleep. But anyway, yeah, freedomfiends.com. And then also for the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, which will be the last weekend in August. I want to say it's the 26th or the 29th. I'm not really sure. But it's the last full weekend in August. And that's mplfest.org. Mike Papalima Fest.org.
Excellent. Wonderful conversation. Thank you very much, everyone. So if anybody wants to help us out, Bitcoin or Patreon, patreon.com/seeds of liberty to help us out with the show, spread freedom and volunteerism all throughout the land. So thank you, everybody. This is Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye. Nice.
Wimes.